Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 27 tells us, "And it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this the judgment." You see, you and I have two appointments with God that cannot be delayed, that cannot be rescheduled, that cannot be altered. The first one is that you will die. And that is that you will close your eyes for the last time. You will draw your last breath. You will see your friends and family for the final moments. You will die. That is the first appointment that most people that have any sense of reality accept. But then after this, you have the judgment. Something that is so blown off. Something that people do not consider. But something that should scare you more than the first appointment of death. And that is, you will stand before an all-righteous, all-holy God and give an account for your sins. So what must you do? You must have your sins be removed from you or suffer the righteous wrath of God for all eternity. The book of Isaiah says, "Come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool." See, you must have your sins be removed from you. And the only way that can be done is through the finished work of Jesus Christ. His death, burial, and resurrection. What are you trusting in to cover you on this appointment of judgment? You see, you make appointments all throughout your life. Maybe you're going to go get coffee tomorrow. Maybe you're saving for retirement. Maybe you're planning to go on a vacation. You have all these things that you think you have fixed in place. But let me tell you, there is something that is much more set in stone than any of that. Because none of that's set in stone. You see, you don't control any of that. You think you do. We think we do. We think we control what's going to go on in our life. But let me tell you, there are two appointments that cannot be changed. And that is, you will die. And then you will come into a judgment. So what are you doing about these two appointments? You may say, "Well, I accept the fact that I'm going to die." Well, welcome to reality. But what about the second portion of this reality? That you will come into a judgment. You may say, "Well, I've done many good things throughout my life. I have had all these meritorious works. I've given to the poor. I've done all these good things." But let me tell you, there's nothing in that that's going to get you out of hell. See, the righteous wrath of God abides on you. And the only thing that can satisfy God is the blood of His Son, Jesus Christ. He says, "Come now, let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow." And let me tell you, no amount of works is going to scrub that scarlet out of that sinful cloth. Only the blood of Jesus Christ can wash that white as snow. What are you doing for your judgment? Maybe you're trusting in Joseph Smith of the Mormons. Maybe you're trusting in Mary Baker Eddy. Maybe you're trusting in Muhammad. Maybe you're trusting in Vishnu. Maybe you're trusting in Buddha. But let me tell you, that all leads to the same place, and that is the place called hell. That is the place called hell. You see, there is no partial gray area. You're either going to heaven or going to hell, and God's going to decide that. God has already decided that on whether or not you have His Son, Jesus Christ. You can't accept His Son as a good teacher. You can't accept His Son as a form of a God, but there were other gods. He must be the only name, because there is only one name that can keep you out of hell, and that is the name of Jesus Christ. That is the only name that can keep you out of hell. It doesn't matter what denomination you hold. You may be a five-point Calvinist and have all the right theology. You may have all the right soteriology down, but that will not keep you out of hell if you do not have the relationship with Jesus Christ. It says, after this, the judgment. You will give an account for all of your sins, all of your thoughts, all of your deeds, all of your actions. And guess what? No matter how much good you think you do, that will not save you. The book of Isaiah says that all of our good deeds are as filthy rags because they come from a sinful source and because they cannot possibly satisfy a thrice holy God. You see, you better start making preparation for these two appointments, especially the second one, the judgment. What will your answer be? What will your plea be on judgment day? What will your plea be when you're standing before the holy, righteous God, Yahweh? If it is anything other than the Son, Jesus Christ, and if it is anything other than the blood of Jesus Christ, then you will have an eternity of torment. You will have an eternity separated from God. You will have an eternity separated from Him permanently. Deuteronomy 32:22 says, "For a fire is kindled in my anger." See, God is very angry with the wicked. The Bible says He's angry with the wicked every day. Deuteronomy 32:22 continues, and shall burn unto the lowest hell. See, hell is a hot, hot place because it is the holiness of God that purifies the wickedness in hell, and it is never ending because it will never satisfy God. You will never satisfy God in your wickedness. And it says, and shall consume the earth with her increase and set on fire the foundations of the mountains. That is how holy and righteous God's wrath is. The wicked shall be turned into hell, and all nations that forget God, that includes the United States of America, contrary to popular belief. If you leave this earth without the blood of Jesus Christ, you will encounter the rich man of Luke 16. It says, there was a certain rich man which was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. This man had everything he wanted. He was rich. He was clothed in the best clothes, but suddenly he died, and he entered into a place called hell. Verse 23 says, and in hell he lift up his eyes, being in torments, and seeing Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. See, hell is not fun like pop culture makes it out to be. We're so desensitized to hell. But it says, being in torment. Being in torment. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me. See, there's no mercy in hell. There's no second chance in hell. Because once you enter hell, you will never leave hell. He said, just one drop of water on my tongue, please, one drop. And that man is still waiting for it till this day, 2,000 years later. My question to you today is, what are you doing about these two appointments that will inevitably come to you, death and then judgment? You should be very scared, because it will not be billions of people standing there arguing on your behalf. You will not have a law firm standing on your behalf arguing for you. It will be you and God, and you will enter into a judgment. And guess what? There will be no way of escape. There will be no innocent plea except through the perfect work of Jesus Christ. And if you are not trusting in that, then there will be no hope for you. Your eternity will be sealed, and you will enter into the place of utter darkness that is called hell, where the worm dieth not, where you are tormented. You will encounter all the unregenerate before you and all the unregenerate after you. In eternity, a billion years will go by, and it will be just the very beginning, my friend. That's why it's important that you seek God while you can. Seek Him while He may be found. Pray that God grants you repentance. Pray that the Lord has mercy on you and grants you repentance, that you may have eternal life. Forsake the foolish things such as your works. Forsake these fallacious views of other religions. Forsake them all, because there is one thing that appeases God, and that is the perfect blood of His Son, Jesus Christ. You know, the flagship verse that we always hear in churches across America is John 3:16. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. And of course we hold true to that, and of course we adore that, and of course we have so much emphasis on the hope that is in that verse. But oftentimes we read John 3:16 and we excommunicate the verses after it. We see in John 3:18, he that believeth on Him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son. You see, you must believe in the name of the only begotten Son, Jesus, who is called the Christ. There are many people out there today trusting in all sorts of things. The law of attraction. There are people trusting in works. There's people trusting in spells and karma. There's people trusting in all sorts of religion. But there's only one name that can keep you out of hell. It's not Muhammad. It's not Joseph Smith. It's not Mary Baker Eddy. It is not Buddha. It's not Vishnu. It's not Odin. There's only one name that can keep you out of hell, and that is the name Jesus Christ. So as I say again in Hebrews chapter 9, it is appointed unto man once to die and then to judgment. You have two appointments with God that you will keep. The first, you will die, and then the second, you will come into a judgment. And if you are trusting in any other thing than the name of the only begotten Son, you are damned. So my question for you today is, what are you trusting in? Are you trusting in your church attendance? Are you trusting in your tithing? Are you trusting in the mere fact that you're studying the Bible? Those are great things, but they're not salvation. Salvation is believing on the finished work of Jesus Christ. The gospel is the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. And if you don't see changes and sanctification in your life from the reception of the Holy Spirit, there is major concern. There should be major concern for you. Paul says to examine yourself to see that you be in the faith. And yet we see so many people in modern day Christendom who are not saved, who have confidence that they're saved but are not born again, that do not have the regenerate spirit of the Holy Spirit. We see this all throughout modern day Christendom. People who claim Christ as their Lord, but they do not follow him. Jesus said in Matthew 7, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not done all of these wonderful things in your name? Haven't we cast out demons in your name? Haven't we prophesied in your name? And he said, I will say unto them, depart from me, ye worker of iniquity. I never knew you. See, profession is not enough to get you into heaven. Your profession means nothing. What is the evidence of your salvation, fellow professing Christians? What is your evidence? Are you seeing a work of God in your life? He who began a good work in you will finish it. If you thought you saw a good work and it ceased, it was never from God. It is important that you continue and you strive to enter that narrow door, for many will try to enter in and will not succeed. What are you trusting in? You have two appointments right now, death and judgment. You better start making preparation for that. You make preparations for your dates, for hanging out with friends, for going to the mall, for going on vacation, for retirement. Where is your effort? Where is your concentration on the two biggest important appointments of your life? Death and judgment. Two things that are guaranteed that no lawyer, no matter how charismatic, no matter how manipulative he is, can get you out of. There will be no institution demanding human rights and civil justice and social justice for your redemption, for your innocence. You see, because they will all be waiting to be judged themselves. What are you trusting on? Who are you trusting in? If it's not the Son of God, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son, there is no hope for you. And that's why it says, seek him while he may be found. He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. So are you seeking God? Because there are two appointments, and you're going to keep them. We ask the Lord to bless the reading of his word today. Thank you, and God bless you.